brain in your cap and gown. Life's daring me to fight, but I ain't backing down. I got travel plans and minivans, caravans, 747s. I still be coming back around. And while I'm out there, can't act a clown. I won't be on the block so I don't have to frown. Man, the world's so beautiful and colorful. It'd be a shame if I only saw black and brown. So I look at my horizons and put in them. It's so surprising, according to them, I should be dead or incarcerated. I'm strung out, but I've come out, and of course I made it. Yeah, despite all the naysayers, I just leave it up to God when I say prayers. From this day forward, I will vow to always cut through the bullshit like cake layers and rise above it all, way above it all. I could be a mixed bag, gotta love it all. Yeah, that's what they told me at the podium. But never let them hold you like ammonium. Stay loose, be ready when your time comes. Stay alert, be ready when the sign comes. Cause you don't wanna miss your calling. Stay in tune while the balloons are in the midst of falling.
Okay, so how are you feeling nowadays? How's your health? And what is it like to be back on tour as a solo artist after a few years break and promoting a brand new album?
Well, I feel great health-wise, a lot of energy. I went to the gym this morning. You know, I'll go again tomorrow morning. Off days, I try to get a little workout in. It's cool to be back on the road as a solo artist. Last couple years, I've been touring with EMC, with Strickland and Wordsworth, and doing those shows. That was fun. But when you do it as a solo artist, it's a little different because everything is kind of you, what you want to do. And so, yeah, it feels good.
Yeah, but it's still almost like EMC because Strickland is with you.
Yeah, but it's a different role, you know, because when it's EMC, we're rhyming equally. Like, he's doing joints, everybody's rhyming the same amount, pretty much. But with my show, he has his verses, but a lot of it is just me having to kind of drive the car. So it's cool. It's different. But it's cool that he's still there because we have chemistry. We've been performing since 2001.
Yeah, incredible chemistry. Like, he's perfect.
Yeah.
And I have a question about one of my favorite songs from you, Good Old Love.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the verses, because even editors and rap genius didn't know how to explain it. The fans kind of act like they glad I'm outing, but they probably sitting at home sad and pouting. So what inspired those two verses, those two lines? Where did it come from? Because it seems like you had a pretty good following back then.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's a lot of people who, you know, sort of made me feel like they wish I would go away, you know, disappear, stop doing music. Of course, it wasn't all the fans, but there's a group of fans that they're not interested in what I'm doing musically now. And so I was just speaking to those fans and about those fans and then saying that they're probably sad and upset that I'm still doing music. It's just a little jab, you know, you throw little jabs at people that don't believe in you.
Yeah. And I remember reading a super long post from Ninth Wonder where he explained his beginnings and how he got started in the rap game. And he said that you were one of the first industry artists to really pay him a considerable amount of money for a beat. Was that the only beat that you bought from him? And why didn't more songs with Ninth Wonder follow?
Yeah, that was the only beat I bought. That was the beat that, the other beats were cool. It was actually on a CD with different producers. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just Ninth Wonder beats, it was other producers mixed in. And, you know, it felt special and I wanted to use that beat. There wasn't, you know, there was other beats that were cool on there, but I knew that was the one. Mm-hmm. And it was towards the end of the album. I had all of the beats kind of lined up already, but that was the one. I was still kind of missing that one kind of kickoff single, and he gave it to me.
Yeah, and why didn't more songs follow with Ninth?
I mean, you know, just busy. He's busy. You know, he started working with Jay-Z and Destiny's Child right after he did Good Old Love. He was in the studio. He came to New York like the next month, and he was in the studio with Jay-Z and Destiny's Child and working on all of that stuff. So once that happened, I said, okay, I'm not gonna be able to afford him anymore. So I was happy for him, but I was just happy I got my beat before he got super expensive.
Yeah, but actually in one of the interviews he said Masta Ace was listening at my brokest times when at my brokest times he was listening, like when nobody supported him. And your new album is produced by a little known producer at the time, Kick Beats.
Yeah.
So what makes you go searching for those new like no-name producers at the time instead of reaching out to someone more established and going the easy route?
I like finding those diamonds. Those diamonds in the rough that nobody knows about. I've done that my whole career. You know, the Slaughterhouse album, a bunch of no-name producers on there. I've always done that. I like finding those kids. Like Crisis is another guy who nobody. I was the first placement for him. He did the song "The Grind," and I heard the beat. I loved it. I didn't care who did the beat. I just knew I wanted to use it. There are a lot of artists that they might like the beat, but if it doesn't say Pete Rock on it or DJ Premier or you know Paulo Brown or somebody like that, then they might shy away from it. I'm the opposite. I would rather use no name guys that have a lot of talent and try to bring them out and let people see them. So Kick Beats is one of those guys. He was a diamond in the rough that once this album comes out, I really believe he's gonna really start to take off. Yeah.
And yesterday at the show, we paid homage to both Five Dog and Sean Price, rest in peace. But it was crazy, like listening to your verse from 2012, from "I Did It," when you already say "I did it for Sean Price."
Yeah.
So, what was your relationship like with Sean, and how do you remember him?
We were cool, man. We were cool. We're both from the same neighborhood in Brooklyn. I'm older than him, so you know, our generations are different, but. We know this a lot of the same people. We ran the same streets, and you know, he was always somebody that, even though we didn't hang out, but we felt like we knew each other. You know what I mean? There was a lady that used to babysit me when I was real little, and she lived like in the next building from him, like right across. And I said her name one day. I said, "Yeah, I used to, this lady in your projects, Irene, used to babysit me." He's like, "Irene on the second floor? Oh, wow, really?" He knows her, she's older now, but he knew exactly who I was talking about. And so those are the kind of things that we had. You know, yeah, just Brownsville all day, obviously. That's my neighborhood, that's where I grew up at. That's who shaped, you know, who I am. And Sean P, same thing.
Yeah. And also one line that stuck out to me when I was listening to the remix of "The Ritual" with Pearl Gates. It was, "used to drive all around town in the traffic playing Tupac Hail Mary, Sound of a Catholic."
Yeah.
And that might seem a bit surprising to some people, knowing how different your lyrics were, like yours and Tupac, but how important was Pac for you as an artist and as a person, his image, his message?
Well, you know, when Machiavelli dropped, because I wasn't, like, I knew Tupac's music, but I maybe felt like a lot of it didn't really connect with me. But then when he put Machiavelli out, and this was after he had passed away, that drop, I really went into that album and listened to the songs and the music, and it hit home. A lot of the music on that album kind of just hit home. For me, anyway. And so I got a stronger appreciation for Pac after he passed away. And you know, that album that had Hail Mary and you know, me and my girlfriend, those kind of records, were dope to me. Yeah.
And did you ever get a chance to meet Pac or be in his presence?
Yeah, I met Pac twice. One time I met him, he was hanging with Biggie. At a club in New York called the Ritz, and he said, "Yo, we gotta work together. And you know, people say that stuff in the industry all the time. So you're like, "Yeah, no doubt, yeah, one day. And then I saw him again, somewhere in like the mid '90s in L.A. At Prince's club, actually. Prince had a club called, I think it was called Glam Slam, and. I saw him, I was leaving, he was coming in. Same thing, "Yo, what's up? Yo, we gotta work together." I was like, yeah. And those are the two times I met him, you know, that never happened, obviously, but it's just cool to know that he wanted to, you know, do something.
And since we mentioned the West Coast and your visit there, let's talk about the grind, the groundbreaking nature of Sittin On Chrome, because it was really one of the first New York records that had a more West Coast sound. Did you feel like you were, and you said that it created issues in your social interaction in your own hometown.
Yeah.
So did you feel like you were walking on thin ice when you were recording it, or did it hit you by surprise, like those negative responses?
Nah, when I was recording it, I didn't think I was walking on thin ice. I was trying to do a record that was dope, that could appeal to both coasts. That's really what I was trying to do. It wasn't like I was trying to do a, you know, West Coast album.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to put some vibes in there, some sounds in there that could maybe, you know, get some attention in other places. You know, you gotta remember when I was working on that album, you know, Dr. Dre had already dropped The Chronic, and The Chronic was like killing everything, So, you know, it was sort of my attempt at making music that felt New York, but also felt other, like it could be other stuff was mixed in there. So it wasn't thin ice for me. It was a deliberate attempt to do music that would appeal to a bigger audience. And you know, for the most part it worked. It just kind of alienated some of my hometown fans because they didn't get it. At the time, you know, hip hop was very much a coastal thing.
Mm-hmm.
There was a rivalry going on between the East and the West, and you know, when Dr. Dre dropped The Chronic and Snoop dropped, you know, Doggy Style, they kind of took over, and New York artists and New York fans were feeling like, who are these intruders? Who are these people from all the way over there? And then all of a sudden they're getting all the airplay and all the record sales, and so they became this, like, you know, us against them mentality, which I never really got down with, because I was always down with, like, I played Ice-T back when he first dropped Power. I was messing with artists from the West Coast, you know, obviously Alcoholics, and King T was another dude that I listened to. So I wasn't with all of that, you know, pick a side and you gotta be down with them or down with us. And I tried to do a record that would work both ways. And it, for the most part, it worked, because I had all these new fans in California, in Arizona, in Texas, that didn't know who I was before I dropped Sittin On Chrome.
Mm-hmm. So what was the reason that you never came back to the sound later on?
It was just, you know, I don't come back to anything. If you look at my, every record is different, right? So that's not my thing, going back. You know, I'm not into doing Disposable Arts part twos and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's more so continuing.
It's each moment in time is a different mindset, different vibe, different energy. And I've never in my career tried to recapture what I did already, because that never works, almost never works. You know, you can think of all the hip hop albums that have come out that have a part two or you know, such and such
it's
two.
Never the same.
So why would I want to, you know, compete with something that people thought was a great record and a great whatever? Just do something new, do something different, and that's what I've always done.
And what was like touring the West Coast for the first time, and do you have some favorite stories from that time?
Well, I mean, we toured the West Coast because, you know, I was signed to a label on the West Coast, and we were out there, you know, almost half of the year doing shows, doing promo, doing interviews. We spent a lot of time out there. A lot of fun times. Got to meet a lot of interesting people while we were out there. I wound up having some friends in the porn industry that hung out with us. I used to hang out a lot with Son Doobie from Funk Dubious.
Mm-hmm.
He was always around. You know, some of the porn girls would come hang out with us, you know, and stuff like that. It was a little, LA was definitely a wilder, more different place, but those are cool memories, and we had a good time at that back then in the 90s. We had a lot of fun. Alcoholics were always around. J-Ro, Exhibit was always around. You know, Tash, everybody. But yeah, we had a good time, man. We had a good time.
And going back to your first album and the single Me and the Biz, you said that there was a lot of backlash for the whole puppet thing. So where did that backlash come from, and how would you compare like hip-hop fans and critics back then to now, how conservative and hard they were on the artists?
Well, you know, the puppet thing, because of where I'm from, right? I'm from, you know, one of the roughest areas of Brooklyn, New York. The puppet thing just felt kind of like a gimmick to people in my neighborhood. So it was more like the neighborhood people cracking jokes, oh, you're puppeteer and this and that, you're doing puppet. This is jokes. It wasn't really, I wouldn't say I would call it backlash. It was just jokes. It was just like a lot of jokes. And, you know, that comes with the territory. It wasn't the single I wanted to put out, but Warner Brothers, they're the big label, they're the big company. They wanted to go with that record, so we went with that record. If it had been my choice, it would have been a completely different single.